When they came out with the Edsel a long time ago, I happened to be the automotive editor for a radio station in Detroit. And take it from me, that was real excitement when that thing came out. But as you well know, it turned out to be a disaster. There's always a flip side, isn't there? Because now, many years later, it's turned out to be something very valuable, and as Craig Worth says, it's worth watching.
Ladies
and gentlemen,
the new features of the beautiful new Edsel, newest member of the Ford family, a fine car.
30 years ago, the first Edsels were rolling off the line. In a few weeks, they would be in the showrooms. There never was a car like it before. The ultimate dream car was here.
How does it feel to own an Edsel?
It's like falling in love.
There soon would be a divorce. Sales bombed, dealers closed, jokes started about horse collars on the front of cars. All the more reason to collect them today. And that's why these people are here, to celebrate the car that cost Ford $350 million in losses. To celebrate the Edsel division that sold but 111,000 cars in 3 years. To celebrate a wonderful American underdog that's risen from the junkyard and into the heart.
I like a convertible. I guess I still feel kind of young at heart.
Oh, your step is snappy.
When you own an Edsel.
The honored spot of the celebration goes to this man, Roy Brown. He was the chief designer of the Edsel.
19 other cars on the road. All of them with horizontal front ends. So we decided the most unique thing was to get something, a combination of something so old that it was new, such as the vertical radiator.
Actually, much of the design was way ahead of its time. The backlights were put up high for safety, just like the backlights of today.
I was proud, absolutely proud. We did what we started out to do, which was to create a car that was different than anything else on the road, and we did it.
The Edsel was partially murdered by timing and the recession of 58. Its marketing campaign wasn't a huge success either, although it's famous. Gail Warnick was the Edsel PR director.
This is the way you sit in the Edsel. Contour seat made for three.
He later masterminded the brilliant Mercury Cougar campaign, but no one talks about that, just the Edsel.
The whole idea was to give the public the impression that this was something brand new.
Getting low on gas,
you can tell in the Edsel when the light goes on.
I loved it. I loved that car. I was like everybody that stood up and applauded when they first saw it.
After just 5 weeks into this, the 1960 model year, the Edsel was finished. The great car of the decade was dead for a while.
And I said at the time, when it was going down the tube, I said, listen to me, that car's gonna be a collector's car someday, and it's nice to be right.
Well, it started as the American dream. It just took the country 30 years to wake up and realize that the Edsel is a great car. Craig Worth, Channel 2 News.
The Ford Motor Company built it, so you know it's good.
Ford's doing all right these days, isn't it? So there is a happy ending after all. Mr. Brown and Mr. Warnick went on to successful Ford projects, and the Edsel, a good one, nowadays sells for many, many times its original cost. So he turned out to be right, the designer,
yeah,
huh?
Very interesting. So if you keep something long enough, it's always
it's
more
always
valuable.
When they first came out, many people scoffed at them and laughed at them and called them lemons. But the people who bought them and held on to them have seen those lemons turn into lemonade, David Dow reports.
So you've got lots full of 81s, and you're paying folks to buy them. Is that what's got you down, Detroit? Well, cheer up, Ford. Buck up, GM and Chrysler. It could be worse. It could be 1958, and your lots could be full of Edsels.
How does it feel to own an Edsel?
It's like falling in love.
You can read about it, hear about it.
As it turned out, the public was not ready to love a car with teletouch shifting, one that dared to be different. For Ford, Edsel was a three-year, quarter-billion-dollar bomb. The people who really loved Edsel were comedians and songwriters.
Hip, hip, hooray for the Edsel! He's going in style all the way. Hip, hip, hooray for the Edsel! You'll never see his dying day.
But return with us to 1981 and hear what some folks are saying about Edsel now.
I wouldn't sell it for anything.
I just love the car. I think they're one of the finest cars that were made.
You can't beat the styling on it. It's just a beautiful car.
Yes, that Oldsmobile sucking a lemon, as one writer described it, is now a classic. There are an estimated 3 to 10,000 Edsels left in the country today, and they are revered by their owners.
The chief designer for the Ford Motor Company, he said he wanted a car that would stand out that you could see a block and a half away. Well, I said it's a car that you can see a mile and a half away and easily identify it. It's just
Max Miller has been told his 58 convertible is worth $10,000 or more. The hood ornament alone, $150. But Max isn't selling. Dennis Irving has collected more than 100 old Edsels to provide parts for Edsel buffs all over the country. He claims to have 39 more in storage, but won't reveal the location for fear of Edsel rustlers.
The lot I had in Glendora was almost completely stripped. It was visible from the street, and it just got out of hand, so I had to move them behind walls, closed walls.
Today's Edsel mania is particularly satisfying to Dave Jenkins, a once-suffering Edsel ad man who tried everything to sell Edsels, including a sort of rebate program. The rebates were Shetland ponies.
It was a terrible problem. We began to get calls from dealers, what do you feed a pony? They never seen a pony up close before. Sent my secretary to the library. All she could find was a book on the care and feeding of horses, so I cut the rations in half.
So hang in there, Detroit. True love rarely blooms at first sight. Sometimes it takes time. David Dow, CBS News, Sierra Madre, California.
And that's the news. I'm Morton Dean, CBS News, Washington. Have a good evening and a good week.
Up next, Clint and his Cadillac and Craig Worth and an Edsel. In every crowd, there is always one who stands out. That's what this story is about. Most of us seem to crave the most popular cars. One man does not. Craig Worth reports.
This is the town of the fancy car. This is the town of Mercedes, Jags, BMWs, which is why Chris Trexler drives an Edsel. Yes, an Edsel. The car with the push buttons in the steering wheel. The car that's the size of a tugboat, although a bit less stylish. The car that has the speedometer that looks like grandmother's bathroom scale.
There are some people who consider themselves to be losers in life, and the Edsel is a kind of the champion of their cause. I don't consider myself to be in that category, however. I just like the Edsel because I think it's unique.
It's sort of like picking up and loving a mangy stray dog.
The handling is actually terrible, I would say. As you can see going around these curves here, it has quite a bit of sway, and it takes quite a bit of concentration to keep it centered in the lane.
You never saw a car like the 58 Edsel.
Never?
It's like falling in love.
You feel the thrill of owning an Edsel.
Oh, your step is snappy.
When you own an Edsel.
Your pulse beats happy.
When you drive an Edsel.
All of this, and yes, folks would kill for it.
This car is not for sale and will never be for sale until I'm too old to drive.
It was built for the yuppies of the 50s. Note only it and the BMW have vertical grills. It just came out before yuppies knew they were yuppies.
I don't think there's anything like them. The sculpturing in the body, the unique taillight design, Edsels are one of a kind. I don't think there's been anything produced like it since.
The Edsel.
So who would drive an Edsel today? The ultimate loser car? Well, some say only losers. Yuppies had failed. Here's my Edsel.
The Ford Motor Company built it, so you know it's good.
Craig Worth, Channel 9 News.
Well, it's a nice Halloween night in Hollywood. Keith and Kelly?
Okay, Phil. The
you're
overweight...
not having any fun, Phil, are you?
The overweight naked lady was very big in our studio.
That's right.
We like his costume too, don't we?
It's not bad, not bad. Now, coming up, Fritz Coleman tells us if our forecast is as chilling as some of those Halloween costumes. And David Sheehan reports in the undisputed queen of Halloween and all things scary, Elvira.
All right, and Joe Rico has the final part of his special report on Californians and their cars. And tonight he's got people who own Edsels and are proud of it. Next.
Well, here in Southern California tonight, there are parades of all strange shapes and sizes,
yes.
But all day, every day, there's a parade on just about any street or boulevard or freeway. It is our car lovers on parade. And tonight, Joe Rico wraps up his special report on the way we're all wild about wheels.
Southern California, car country. Thousands of miles of pavement and about 9 million cars to fill in the blanks. And so there is some truth to the notion that the Southland is a favorite dumping ground for automotive ideas.
It's really funny. You bought an Edsel.
From the day 110,000 Edsels came off the production line, the laughter hasn't stopped. Only in Southern California has the Rodney Dangerfield of Detroit gained widespread respectability. Imagine, Edsel car clubs.
There's strength in numbers, you might say, and safety in numbers, too. So when you have an Edsel, you don't want to be traveling alone. Whenever I go anyplace with my Edsel, I file a flight plan.
It was a big failure in 1958, and today it's not a failure. People admire the car, and they think the styling is neat. And for 1986, you couldn't have a better car, I don't think.
If an engineering flaw or mutation can be fastened onto four wheels, it'll find a home in the hearts of Southern Californians.
People say you are what you drive, and so I think that there's some truth to that.
Now, that philosophy is flattering to some. Others might take offense. To live and drive in L.A., it's a world like no other. Just as the good times are fast and fun, so the ending is slow and seemingly tortuous. Because when man's second best friend dies, it dies hard. And like the beginning, it isn't alone. Joe Rico, Channel 4 News.
Our first spot's kind of interesting, I think, because, you know, every once in a while in our country, or any country, I suppose, a large business that has been hugely successful year after year after year will suddenly come out and make one colossal mistake and produce a product that just bombs all over the place. About 1958, that happened when the Ford Motor Company came out with the Edsel. One of the great bombs of all time, and there are all sorts of theories as to why it happened. We have a gentleman who will tell you he thinks the Edsel was the greatest car ever invented, and what he's doing to keep it alive. As soon as we meet our panel, here on To Tell the Truth.
Bill Cullen. Kitty Carlisle. F. Lee Bailey. Peggy Cash.
All righty. Did any of you ever ride in an Edsel, let alone drive an Edsel?
I rode in one, yeah.
Did you
like
it?
I think I must have.
I enjoyed it. My Edsel was, my financial manager bought two or three Edsels. They used to ride me back and forth to the tax court. No, they were good.
Well, you're not alone in thinking that. Let us at this moment meet an Edsel fan. Hard to find.
Number one, what is your name, please?
My name is Edsel Henry Ford.
Number two.
My name is Edsel Henry Ford.
Number three.
My name is Edsel Henry Ford.
And that's a name you don't kid around with, right? All right, here is his automotive report. He says, I, Edsel Henry Ford, am co-founder and first president of the Edsel Owners Club of America. This is an international group of Edsel owners who really love their cars. 1958 was the year when this revolutionary automobile was first unveiled. No car in history was so immediately disparaged. The Ford Motor Company took a $250 million drubbing. But cast your eyes upon this marvelous machine as we roll some film to the accompaniment of one of the catchy, non-selling commercials.
The 1958 Edsel. When you see it, you are sure it's the Edsel. When you drive it, then you know it's the newest car in the world by far. The engine motors will go, go, go. When you're out on the highway, the Edsel makes you want to be alive. See your Edsel dealer and take the ride.
Perhaps you noted that the Edsel shift buttons were right in the middle of the steering wheel. No other automobile can make that statement. Signed, Edsel Henry Ford. And our sponsors will come in right about here and sell you something a little more up to date, then we'll come back and play the game. Friends, we are fortunate. Across the way, we have three gentlemen, each of whom claims to be Edsel Henry Ford, who takes a passionate interest in restoring and preserving the Edsel automobile. And let's start with a fellow who remembers the running board days.
Certainly do. And the rumble seat. Indeed. Number two is, just for the record, is Edsel Henry Ford your real name?
Yes, it is.
Number three, are you any relation to the Ford family at all?
No relation to the Ford of Detroit.
A coincidence, per se.
We're the poor Fords.
Number three, in along about 1939, Ford brought out another new product, a new car that today still does very well. Do you know what that was?
1939?
39-40.
I would say it must be the Lincoln.
What Lincoln, number three?
I don't know much about Lincolns.
Thank you. Number one, there was an automobile put out a little bit before the Edsel that had the great feature of, as you turned a corner, a middle light mounted in the center of the car would turn in the direction of your wheel. And that car was a success, I think, about equal to the Edsel. Do you know what that car was, number one?
That was a three-wheeler.
And who made it?
Ford.
Number two, do you have an idea for that car I'm talking about with a headlight to turn?
I believe it was a Tucker.
And did Henry Kaiser, number two...
Whoops, we got a buzzer and we're going on to Kitty.
Thank you. Number one, you're not related to the rich Fords either?
No.
How come you got the name Edsel Henry Ford?
Well, actually, I changed my name to Edsel when we formed the club 1957.
What was your real name?
Edward.
Edward Henry Ford.
Edward Henry Ford.
I see. Well, number two, why did everybody think the Edsel was so lousy?
It wasn't so lousy. It was a wonderful car, but it came out at the wrong time economically.
Oh, was it too expensive?
No, but it was the projection, the market research and projection showed that at the time it was going to be good, and it wasn't.
Well, number three, can you tell me why people thought it wasn't any good?
I don't know. I think it was a threat to the other dealers, and I do know that the other dealers were told to refer to it in derogatory terms, such as it looks like a Mercury sucking a lemon.
Number one, do you think there was sabotage involved with the poor Edsel?
Yes, I do. It was very competitive around that time.
And do you think the other dealers said terrible things about it?
I'm sure they did.
And that's why it didn't work?
That's right.
We got a buzzer, and Lee.
Number two, the Edsel had the push-button shift in the center of the wheel, but another prominent car had one just off the steering column. What was that other car?
DeSoto, I believe.
And number two, where did the Edsel fit in the Ford line when it was manufactured?
It came between Ford and Mercury and between Ford and Lincoln. It was an effort to give them a trade-up within the family, within the Ford family.
How did it compare with the Mercury price-wise?
The price-wise, the price range was about $2,500, as high as $5,000, depending on the options that you exercised.
And the Mercury at that time?
Was around $3,400.
All right. What was the horsepower of the Edsel engine?
The horsepower of the Edsel, there were two Edsel engines. One was 305, and the bigger one was 345.
Number one, did you ever hear of Preston Tucker?
Yes.
What did he make?
He made the Tuckermobile.
Yes, thank you. Number three, is that right?
The Tuckermobile? Well, the Tucker, to be exact.
Did you ever hear of the Tucker Torpedo?
All righty, and that takes us on to Peg.
Number one, why do you think people laughed at the Edsel? Because it's the butt of many jokes.
Essentially because of its radical design, departure from the norm, the fact that it looked strange, the fact that it had a very large public relations buildup in the early stages, and it didn't meet expectations.
Well, number one, it was named after one of the Fords, the Edsel. Has anybody ever named, was there a Sam Buick or a Charlie Mercury? I mean, don't you think that was part of the reason to name a car after yourself seems sort of a little self-aggrandizing, no?
No, the Edsel was named...
Two, I said, I thought. I'm sorry. Don't you think it was...
Well, it was partially sentiment, partially symbolical. Edsel was president of the company from 1919 to about 1933.
I see. Well, now, number three, how many miles did the Edsel get to a gallon?
Which engine?
Oh, well, I don't know about that stuff. Number two, if you were going to resell your Edsel today, would it be worth as much as when is there an Edsel's secondhand value now as much as their new Edsel was?
Right at the moment, the secondhand value runs anywhere from zero or takeaway to perhaps $20,000, depending on condition, and rust is one of the major factors in this price.
But number two or three, if you'd kept it in the barn and never used it, would it be worth $20,000? Number three?
I don't know of one going for $20,000 at this time.
Oh, number one, was that commercial by the Andrews sisters?
Oh, I wondered that myself, but anyhow, what we did was get ourselves a bell instead, so we'll just have to wonder as we wander, and we wander amongst the numbers one, two, or three, and let's take them. Take a look at one. What do you think? And let's take another look at number two. And examine very carefully number three and make up your mind. And what we're going to do here is we give the group $50 for each wrong guess. You get $500 if nobody comes up with the right Edsel fan, and Bill Cullen starts.
They were all good. Number two, really, if he is not the right one, he's sure read up on his Edseldom, or whatever you want to call it. However, number three has the look of someone who wants to help the poor and downtrodden. And for that reason, I voted for him.
All right, so we have a three showing in Kitty Carlisle.
Well, I should have voted for number two because he said trade up, which sounded very knowledgeable. I don't know what it means, but a trade up in the car business. However, I voted for number one. I think he knows what he's talking about.
All right, we got him on both ends. And Lee Bailey, where are you going to go? In the middle.
I think that only someone who had to defend that push-button shift would know about the DeSoto.
All right. Everybody has got one. Miss Peggy, you're going to be either helpful or a terrible hindrance.
Well, I thought number two might have had an Edsel dealership. He knew so much about them. But this, and number one, I don't know. But number three, he's a sort of a humble, sweet person, and I think he took on after the Edsel.
I think that's dear. I really do. And we are now going to find out. The votes are all in. Will the real Edsel Henry Ford please stand up? Yeah! That's a really a good team. Gentlemen, you were well briefed and you learned your lessons. Now, number one, what is your real name? What do you do?
My name is James Airy, and I'm Director of Public Relations for Pan American World Airways.
And number two, can you tell me about you, please?
My full name is Thornton Ford Hard. I'm a retired Army officer. I live in Centerville on the eastern shore of Maryland.
My country. Thank you very much. And I want to tell you, I think it's great that everybody have a drive in life the way you have, you know, something that you really care about that way. So few people do. Thank you very much, Mr. Ford. Thank you, gentlemen. Take care.
Twelve years ago, a new face in automobiles appeared on American highways. The Ford Motor Company presented to the motoring public a car engineered for the future. The Edsel was something less than a smashing success. It is remembered mainly for its horse collar grill and the jokes it generated about losers. Americans still laugh at the Edsel, but a new breed of Edsel owner may also have reason to laugh back. 500 members of the National Edsel Owners Club are creating a new demand for the once obsolete car. They happily describe themselves as loser lovers.
Gentlemen, start your Edsel.
This unlikely scene was the high point of the first Edsel Owners Convention. Flying formation of 50 Edsels rounding the Indianapolis 500 Speedway must have set Ford's corporate heart aflutter. Today, the Edsel has attracted a band of tenacious admirers. Their mission is to restore the car to its rightful, lofty place in automotive annals. They also hope this will increase the Edsel's market value.
Hey, boy,
Good to see you.
The first order of business was to inspect new arrivals' hood ornaments. One Edsel owner's common complaint is that hippies steal the green E emblems to wear with their love beads.
You mean the hippies got that one, too?
Apparently so.
Edsel Ford told me that boys out in San Francisco can't keep them. Hippies hang around their necks.
We can't even keep them in Illinois.
That's what I told him. I said, there's a junkyard in the country that has been scrounged for one. Hey, Edsel, come over here. Have you seen Alan yet?
Hello, Alan. Glad to meet you.
He's the biggest Edsel in the bunch.
You're right.
The club's president is named Edsel Henry Ford. He is a hospital dietitian and not related to the Detroit Fords. He explains that his father greatly admired the original Henry Ford.
How many you got now?
I've got six.
Just six.
How many do you have, Alan? Is the only one?
Just four.
Just four.
You guys are pikers. I got eight of them.
Well, we're playing the numbers game. We got a guy out in California who has 16 of them.
60 members came from 18 states to gloat over their Edsels. The first Edsel hit the showrooms in 1958. When the last one left the assembly line in 1960, Ford had made 110,000 Edsels and had lost $250 million. How are you doing? A beauty contest for Edsels sent judges kicking tires and peering under floorboards. One contestant was so overcome by a half acre of assembled Edsels that he broke into an impassioned used Edsel pitch.
The overall Edsel picture shows more firsts than any other car ever put on the market. Start up in the front and look at the dual headlights, the first 58 car to hit the road with dual headlights. Drop down to the bumper, you've got rubber bumper guard, the first bumper guard. First rubber bumper guard, and so help me, you sure need them today. Look at that push-button steering wheel. Push the buttons, standard shift, all done automatically. We had a adjustable dial-type control on the heater. It also had a multiple range air conditioner, so everything was locked in together. All this Edsel was loaded with firsts. When the Edsel owner went down the street, he didn't know it then, but he had some of the same gadgets that today the boys that went to the moon were using, in a little more sophisticated way, of course. This was an automobile that was as fantastic in 1958 as some of the things the astronauts are doing. Believe it or not.
Before the judges finished, the cloud hanging over the Edsel owners burst.
This has been our first national. I've been elected as the president. I don't see how it could have been any other way. When Nixon was running for president, and I had a Nixon sticker on my Citation convertible, shortly after, when he got the nomination, I took one of the Nixon Agnew stickers, and all apologies to Mr. Agnew, but I cut Mr. Agnew up and put him under Nixon to spell again, Nixon again. So I feel that we helped Mr. Nixon quite a bit. Perhaps the Edsel might have helped shoot him down in the beginning, but I think we made him president.
It's me again.
Alan Payne from Illinois is a shoe salesman.
To introduce to you our own number 44 member, who will speak to us on the Edsel story as told by one survivor. That survivor is Mr. David Jenkins of Glen Allen, Illinois.
Thank you so much. Now, I think there were a lot of jokes going around today about the three-time loser. Believe me, you're looking at the original three-time loser. My first job out of college was a Packard Motor Car Company. I'm an ex-Kaiser Frazier dealer, and I worked with the Edsel from about 19 months prior to its introduction until we went to the wake. There was nothing wrong with the product. But here, this car came out. Up goes the curtain. The biggest single thing that went wrong, I would attribute to bad timing.
Jenkins said the Russian Sputnik hurt the Edsel since American prestige suffered and automobile sales slumped. He also blamed the motoring public, which bypassed Edsel luxury for small car economy.
And I sure thank you all for listening to me tonight.
And the 58th most outstanding, Mr. McKinney.
This may have been the first time an Edsel ever won anything.
Second place goes to Mr. Kenneth Coulter.
We have four Edsels. We joined the club about a year ago. The reason we like them, they're a distinctive automobile. You don't see too many of them around. They're fairly rare, and we enjoy driving them.
Well, there are people that are asking $5,000 for a car that you would have sold it for $25 about, what, 2 or 3 years ago.
This Pennsylvania family has collected 16 Edsels.
My dad keeps his Edsels back in the woods.
Well, some are stored in an old chicken house, and some are out in the woods, hidden in the summertime. But most of the time, they're back far enough so we don't have to see all of them at one time.
Right after the market fell out of Edsels, I bought a 58 Citation convertible from a local Ford dealer for a real good price, because they were stuck with Edsels at that time, and we used that as a family car. Everybody knows that we have Edsels, and any time an Edsel goes by, why, it's us. It's nobody else.
We took our honeymoon in an Edsel, and people have told us that if the marriage fails, something else we can blame on the Edsel.
People are trying to buy them now for an investment, to my knowledge. That's the reason I'm keeping hold of this one. I wanted to trade it off, but of course the wife wouldn't listen to it, so I've still got it. Thankful now I do have.
Gentlemen, the club's executive board seemed alarmed by rumors of outrageous prices for Edsels. But they were smug, knowing that their Edsels are worth more now than they ever were.
Call it the rumors or the fact of the Edsel selling for many thousands of dollars. We all are aware of the true selling price of an Edsel. I mean, we are the ones that have the knowledge of what Edsels are selling for. I don't know how many of you saw the TV program the other evening, but this well-known female economist appeared, and she was discussing what to do with your money. She says if you should invest your money in something that will increase in value. And the next thing she said just scared the devil out of me. She says, buy an Edsel. Now, this is kind of rough on us, because it will inflate our prices even more. And Willard, what'd you pay for your last Edsel, for example?
Well, the last one, didn't pay too much, but the highest one I've known sell in my area, I guess I bought myself $500.
How many Edsel you bought?
I've got 14 that I'm fixing up. I'm gonna.
You ought to
14.
Be an expert. But you got $500 tied up in all of them?
No.
A little bit more.
Edsel club members won't even tell each other how much they paid for their cars, or what they would sell them for.
Downgraded so many years that it's worth more than $35. You know that.
Yes, I've seen some that worth more than $35. I agree.
But I've seen some cars that were a year old that were not worth $35 too. But yeah. The thing that I want to see is I want to see the Edsel sell for what it's actually worth,
not
degraded because it was an Edsel.
You can darn well thank the Edsel Owners Club for anything you get over $150.
You mean you should thank us even for having a market for it?
Amen.
People generally would buy an Edsel because their neighbor doesn't have one, unless they have an eccentric neighbor also. There's various reasons. Presently, they're considered a good investment. In fact, one of the leading financial consultants in a syndicated column just a few weeks ago mentioned among good things to invest in were Edsels. Their value is dictated quite a bit by the rarity of the model. For instance, our 60 convertible is one of eight known to exist today. Our 58 Citation convertible has another little distinction. It's the biggest Edsel ever built. Then we have a six-cylinder model for economy. It's a 59. And then the little Pacer that we're driving today is just sort of a general all-around Edsel. The ribbing has changed a good bit since the formation of the Edsel Owners Club. You were once looked upon as some sort of a nut, and now you're considered sort of a shrewd investor.
In this nation of ours, which is so impressed with winning, it's encouraging to find there are still people, like the Edsel owners, who are committed to lost causes. It's easy to cheer a winner, but it takes real imagination to revere a man or a company that has snatched defeat from the jaws of success. The Edsel owners do not stand alone. There are the Friends of Richard III, who are dedicated to proving that Shakespeare's villain was really Captain Nice. There is the Millard Fillmore Day Memorial Society, which is persevering in its efforts to prove that our 13th president was something more than a Whig dropout. Each year, the Society publishes a book called Milestones with Millard. But the real champions have to be the members of Britain's Flat Earth Society, who are still sticking to their guns, still trying to convince us that the Earth is flat, despite what we have all seen on television. But is owning an Edsel really a lost cause? In this homogenized, categorized society of ours, an Edsel does set a man apart. He is now a member of a cult. At long last, the Edsel bestows status and distinction, although not quite in the way its makers had in mind.